privilege to be here amongst you. And please allow me to thank the organizers for this event. I'd love to list the names, however, I'm sure I will leave somebody out, but a big thank you for the excellent organization. It's clear before coming here that everything was being thought of. So a big thank you, and a thank you also to the sponsors of this event. It's very interesting for me to come here and also see how academia, together with industry, is discussing these very important topics. And it's a great pleasure to see also the students here amongst you. I have to see more in other countries the students participate. On a personal note, I have to say I'm very happy to see a number of female students amongst you. We need more of you. So thank you for being here. I just would like to give you a little overview, first and foremost, about the European Tugowners Association. It is an association which represents Tugowners amongst European countries. Today we have 85 members coming from 24 countries. We are geographically covering Europe, so not just the European Union. So we have 30 amongst our membership, in fact we have five members from Turkey, and I'm very happy to see three of which are also your sponsors amongst for this event. And together what we do is first and foremost create a platform for our Tugowners to be able to network amongst themselves, but also then as an association we represent the interests of Tugowners at a European level with policymakers in Europe, but also more and more with IMO and ILO. So the role is really twofold for this association. One is really bringing together Tugowners, and especially in this kind of commercial climate, more and more there is a need for Tugowners to meet together, to discuss and also do business together, but also then affect and influence regulation. And to this effect, this is why today I will be speaking more on whatever is going on the regulatory aspect in Europe, which affects the towage industry. On the other hand, however, also what's happening commercially and how this is impacting the towage sector. So at the European level, maritime policy is focusing on three main areas, which were the priorities over the last few years, priorities set until 2020, and we're pretty sure they remain priorities even after 2020. And these are competitiveness, decarbonization, and digitalization. In terms of competitiveness, the main work which has been carried out was what is now being referred to as Fourth Package G. It's an agreement which member states have only signed this year. It's a regulation. It will come into effect in 2019, and its aim is competitiveness within the port sector, and also transparency and governance. In terms of competitiveness, the aim is really to try and bring about ports which are more commercially oriented, which offer more opportunities where different companies can compete to deliver the services within the ports. As an association, we have been quite disappointed, I have to say, with this directive, this regulation, because it started off as a regulation which covered all port services, but ended up in a regulation which now covers only four port services, and these are towage, mooring, anchoring, and port reception facilities. And it covers the minor aspect of port facilities, but it's a regulation which came into force. It's a regulation. Needs to be, to a certain extent, protected, even though the word protected is not used. So this is another development which will be interesting to see and to see how it will be implemented. In terms of digitalization, the main focus has been very much on what is called the single window for ships. At the moment, ships enter into ports and have all the different paperwork which needs to be done, and there is a whole drive to have a single window. So one set of paperwork which is done, irrespective of whichever port the ship visits. And this has been, I would say, a very difficult story which keeps evolving. Because now we do not have a single window. And the reality is, because every port has its own systems, has its own paperwork, even within the same country, one port does not necessarily have the same paperwork as the other port. So in actual fact, we only see about 40% of ports which could possibly tangibly start working towards this single window. Directly, this does not affect us as a towage sector. What does affect us is how there will be interoperability in the ports, in the digital services of the ports. So how the port and the towage company systems of digitization will actually be competitive. And this has, not competitive, interoperability. So they can meet each other. And this will be interesting to see because, as we know, the more information is shared, the more information is open, the more efficient one gets in timings. And I don't know here in the ports, in your ports, but in some ports of Europe, particularly the very busy ports, the timing is of essence. And when in the whole chain there is one particular block which doesn't deliver, this affects the whole chain. So this kind of digitization is definitely something which will affect us, which we as an ETA are very open to and willing to see happening. It would also have its impact on the company, because this means every company needs to be training its staff, changing the culture, culture that moves away from paperwork and going more and more towards digitization. Training also people on the ships, where today on tugs, most of the work is not just the work of towage, but also most of this work is also digitized. And so having a culture in which this is part and parcel to one's job. Part of this digitization strategy is the autonomous vessels, which I will not go into because my colleague and friend will be speaking more about autonomous vessels, but this is obviously a big, important sector for our future, which will be affecting both the towage and the pilotage sector. So, This digitization strategy is one which we will keep on seeing in the future. However, I would remark that potentially not much emphasis is being given on cyber security, where here possibly we are still a little bit slow in being able to preempt the issues of cyber security. And we see this happening in reality, because the big hack we have had just a few months ago, which affected globally a number of companies, also affected the largest storage company, where we had Switzer, which is also our member, having been completely locked out because of this hack and not being able to use their systems. So, with a strategy of digitization, proper thinking on cybersecurity needs to be done. And this is where we need to be seeing a little bit more thinking in this respect. The third approach towards in the maritime strategy, in the EU maritime strategy, is decarbonization. And where is decarbonization primarily affects the big ships? Because as of this year, every ship over a specific tonnage had to report to every port its emissions. In terms of tugboats, we are not of that size, so we don't need to be reporting in this respect. However, we will be seeing developments on the trading emissions scheme, where this year the Parliament has decided that the shipping sector, the maritime sector, should also form part of the trading emissions scheme. But what practical impact does decarbonization have on us as an industry? The first thing is, and this is what our job is to try and also make policymakers more aware, is that the lifespan of a tug is different to the lifespan of a ship. A ship is constantly being used, so it has a lifespan of, let's say, 25 years, where this is different to that of a tug. Here we see a number of tugs beyond this age still being used. So there is this nuances, this difference between a tug and a ship in this respect. We're also seeing, however, a change in fuels. So we see a greater emphasis being done on LNG. LNG boats as a fuel for the ships themselves, but LNG being also used more extensively in Europe. And this affects us in a direct way because till today, we do not have a clear way of addressing accidents which may happen at sea in terms of energy. So we can tow energy vessels. We know how to get them to port, how to moor them, but effectively and truly, when it comes to salvage, in which the tow sector involved, there is no clear evidence on how to deal with such accidents. So till now, because it is relatively a safe sector and LNG is quite safe, we have not heard of major accidents. However, in terms of salvage, till now, salvage can be done only if LNG remains dry and intact. And this is where I think academia particularly play an important role in also helping out in developing methodologies in dealing with LNG accidents. Because if something were to happen in our seas or beyond our seas, this would be disastrous. Another impact is that we're seeing bigger vessels. The investment in the shipping industry means bigger vessels, we have mega ships which are not necessarily, according to statistics, being all filled up. However, mega ships mean that we, as a towage sector, need to adapt for these very big vessels. It means we will be having lesser calls in ports at specific timing. And therefore, it means our tugs need to be stronger because they have to deal with these mega vessels, but lesser used because we will have lesser calls into the ports. This indicates that as a towage sector, we need to be thinking strategically of how to plan our contracts. So now moving more from a regulatory aspect into a commercial aspect. As a sector, we need to be thinking of maybe changing the way we do contracts with our clients, offering more specific, possibly changes in prices for peak times and lesser times. But it also obviously means a bigger investment. And here I know the ship builders will be very happy about the fact that more powerful tugs needs to be built and purchased. But then on the other hand, it is not necessarily that every tug company can make this investment. Another impact that these memberships are having and will continue to be having is a membership in itself determines the kind of ports it can go into. This might mean that specific ports might be left out from the ports of call of big clients, because obviously there are constraints of draft, size, and reception facilities. So in actual fact, for smaller companies which might operate in one or two ports, this would have some significant impact in actually seeing lesser vessels coming to their ports. From a commercial perspective, what we are experiencing in Europe is more alliances being done. So the alliances which are happening at a shipping level will also determine alliances which are happening on a tax sector. You also have shipping sectors which own tank companies and determine also specifically those alliances. And particularly in these last few years, we've seen more and more takeovers within the tackle sector. So smaller companies have been taken up, over by larger companies. So where does this leave then the rest of the tackle companies? And an opportunity which lies ahead and which I believe is a trend for not just the sustainability, but the survival of tank companies which are small and medium-sized, is having more and more agreements amongst themselves. The more and more smaller and medium-sized companies get together and offer a more holistic service to their clients, showing a specific amount of ports which can be reached through this form of agreement amongst these small companies, this is where survival has a greater potential. So the trend is bigger alliances, getting together, and takeovers. And this is really a result of seeing, particularly in the north of Europe, a very varied competitive environment, where prices for towage have been slashed down so much that one sometimes, I mean, I as a non-technical person, I sometimes wonder that price actually covers the fuel of doing just the towage, the fuel cost. So we are living in a reality where it is highly competitive, where it is the survival not just of the fittest, but of the ones who can stick it out for longest. But it's also the survival of the smartest. So the smartest are the ones who realize how the business is changing and anticipate with strategic alliances. One small area, if you allow me, which I will just add and I'll just mention on which does affect us commercially, but I think this is an experience which it's not only us as a sector, is the people we employ. There are lesser and lesser availability, supply of people to work in the sector. So for the last few years, we had a little bit of an advantage having the oil sector being slightly affected and regressing in terms of work, that this supplied quite a few people to the sector, but it is a sector together with the shipping sector. We're seeing a lesser and lesser supply for the workforce we have. So this is the overall scenario. It is not all doom and gloom, because there are opportunities, and the opportunities are there for the ones who are wise enough, fast enough, and smart enough to be able to think and take these opportunities. It's definitely a time where the status quo will not last forever. It's a time where good reflections need to be done. And this is why a conference like this is particularly useful. because this is where we can be thinking strategically for the future. From the perspective of the European Tugowners Association, we are looking at the future in terms of also being able to offer a platform for these companies to get together and really forge these alliances, particularly the smaller and medium-sized companies. We ourselves, as an association, are building more and more our alliances with our European counterparts, because we need to all together be able to preempt the maritime strategy, and now is a crucial time. We'll be thinking beyond 2020. So, I will conclude on this, note. I want to thank you for having patiently listened to what I have said, and I will be very happy to be able to answer any questions you might have, either now or in the coffee break. Thank you very much, and I wish you a great success.
Thank you. Wait, please wait. Please, if you have any questions, would you please raise now to her? We have many captains. They like to speak, I think. Okay, please. Yeah, microphone, please. I hope one will bring. You can. Yeah, it's coming. Sorry. I'm not a good coordinator.
Hello, my name is Willem Benzing. I'm the managing director of the Dutch Pilot Organization, and thank you very much for an interesting speech and talk. I was just triggered by your last words that it's difficult to find able seamen to work on these tugs. I believe later on there's also going to be a talk about autonomous tugs. Do you believe that the shortage in personnel, seagoing personnel, is a drive to develop these autonomous tugs and perhaps also ships?
If I were to look at the strategies adopted till now to try and attract people to the maritime sector at a European level, I would say the strategies have failed miserably if one can call them strategy, because one cannot really see a clear strategy over there. And I think from a regulatory perspective, there is more and more this drive, particularly as a solution to the fact that we do not find people to work within the sector. It is not necessarily the solution, but yes, it is one of the driving force. However, we still have a crisis in the interim. So if we were to look at a perfect world in which we would have the perfect autonomous vessels, we still have, again, this big shortage that's occurring. And I would say, as compared to pilotage, tug sector is more effective because generally, it is a very specific kind of profile of people who want to work on a tug. A number of our members have actually said that we get people who want to be staying more closer to their hometown and don't want to be doing long distance shipping any longer for a variety of reasons. And they choose then to work on a tug because it's very local. And then they start working on a tug and they just can't take it. Just because I can understand, it's very daunting being on a bridge, on a small tug, under this massive megaship, which in previous years this person would have been the master of such megaship. So to answer your question, I would say it must be one of the driving force. I would choose you.
Thank you. I think I have one specific question to your side. As far as I am concerned, you're all insisting that the European Commission should increase the budget for transport services. Would you please briefly explain your reasons? Thank you.
whole, it's primarily in the 10T financing project. And here, as not just as PTA, but the whole maritime cluster, there's a big emphasis for asking for an increase in this budget, which we know we won't get. The budget has been increased over the years. At least, one would say, it has not been decreased so drastically. But primarily, it's because of there's a whole emphasis on being greener, having more sustainable transport. And you know, as compared to road transport, maritime transport tends to be greener, especially short sea shipping. Now, we have an amount of possibility of inland maritime transport, which are not being exploited so much or have not been developed so much. So we still have specific areas which are overloaded, and other areas, because infrastructure has not been developed well enough, where potentially could be developed or could be used and have this greener greener effect. So this is one of the reasons why we're claiming to have an increase in budget. And it's also because, let's face it, still 90% of the world trade happens at sea. And irrespective of the emphasis which has been given on the day aviation, rail, still most of the trade is moved around in sea. And our budget does not reflect this.
For maritime especially, you mean? The same may be valid for Turkey. In Turkish governmental budget, we spent about 1.5% among the other transport expenditures. Very low for maritime from our public budget. That is the same problem. Okay, thank you. If any more question, okay, the last question. Would you please introduce yourself to the audience as well? Microphone, belki anlamıyorlar. Kısa tutalım soruyu da mümkünse.
Tamam hocam, çok kısa bir şey. İsmim Yiğit'i, Enisiyar Dosyeti Müşürvesi'nin tutuk üyesi. Birinci konu, Ankara'ya sormak istediğim, Avrupa Birliği'nin özellikle yabancı yatırımlar konusunda, stratejik yatırımlar konusunda bir koruman politikasından söylemek istedim. Çin burada ana başlık olarak belirtti, Çin'i belirtti. Global dünyanın neden korumaya çalışıyor? Yani neyi korumaya çalışıyor Avrupa Birliği? Birinci soru bu. İkinci de otonomuz gibilerden ve belki de insansız telefonlardan bahsediyoruz. Yetişmiş ve yetişmekte olan iş gücümüz ki bu 2020-2025 gibi yıllardan bahsediyor. Ne yapacak? Çok global olarak da dünyadaki 8.000'den insan nasıl employ edilir? Teşekkür ederim.
Okay, could you understand?
For your question. I hope my audience did well, and I take the opportunity to thank the interpreters for doing an excellent job. I have used the word protectionism. This is a taboo word in the European Union, so I shouldn't have used it. But I say things the way they are. It is a form of protectionism. It is not implemented. It is only an announcement that has been done by Juncker in his presidential speech, State of the Union speech last September. But in actual fact, if I'm saying from how me and my counterparts see it, is that in reality we have China, which has invested in a number of ports in Europe. We have a number of ports which are now owned by China. And ports are strategic assets. And unless, and I'm glad the European Union has at least put a mention, this means it's something that it is thinking about. Because unless we think of how we are, I would say the word protect, but let's say safeguard how can we safeguard assets should be something we need to be thinking about, because otherwise time keeps passing and we will see more and more of our strategic assets being purchased by China. And whereas this is directly the impact of ports, and until now the towage sector is not been affected by China, but we do see other services, such as, for example, dredging, which is being affected, and we see more and more of the Chinese players taking the place of the European players. So, to answer your question, there is no fair plan. There is the idea that we should be thinking about it. But what happens is once something is put in the State of the Union speech, this means that possibly when we will be having the next maritime strategy, this will be something the European Union will be looking into. Regarding the employment, yeah, I agree with you. What will we be doing with all the ones which are already in that sector? And this is why I don't think it will be a transition which will happen so fast. Here I'm with my colleague to be speaking about that. What definitely we need to be doing is thinking more of also not necessarily the redeployment, but the enhancement of the skills of our maritime sector. So people who already are working within this sector, how to enhance their skills to be not just people who are extensively competent at sea, but people who are extensively competent with the current and the future tools which will be happening, which is information technology, which, looking at our young bodies, I'm pretty sure for the younger generation this is not a problem. The difficulty lies for a generation which is already doing this job, which needs to be able to also have these skills and be professional with these skills. But yes, this is something where our associations will definitely be working on, not to have what you're saying, what happens to those 8,000 people who already work within the sector. So I think it is our social obligation to also be dealing with that question. I hope I answered your question.
Okay. We thank you to Miss Anna Maria Damanin.